Today we will talk about receptive field estimation. Welcome to this lecture in our lecture series, Neural Data Science. So what makes a neuron fire? In the last lectures, we discussed already the concept of tuning curves. In tuning curves, we had a simple parametric stimulus that we modulated and then changed the firing rate of the neuron. Typically, tuning curves are a concept that is used if the stimulus is one or at max two-dimensional. In general, and one can view that as a generalization of that question, we still would like to answer the question, what in the stimulus or what in the behavior of an animal makes a certain neuron fire? So one example here could be weakly electric fish in the electrosensory lateral line lobe. They have an electrosensory organ that is able to sense fluctuations in the electric field around them, and the neurons react to that. So if we have a stimulus here, a modulation of the electric field around the fish, and record from the activity of a certain unit in these neurons, in this lateral line lobe, then we find that it spikes sometimes. And if you look closely and look for relationships between these two signals, you will see that these spikes occur mostly on the falling phase of the receptive field, of the electric field. How can we make this relationship a bit more quantitative? We can build a linear model between our stimulus and the electrical activity of the neuron. So we can try to estimate the rate as a convolution of the stimulus with a receptive field kernel. And if we compute this kernel in that case, this looks like that. So if the stimulus was up and then was falling, the neuron spiked, what we already suspected. In general, the theory behind that, one can goes back to series expansion. This works somewhat similar, like Taylor expansions for functions, but here we expand a function in terms of other functions. And these kernels here, these we use as our receptive fields that describe the relationship between our stimulus and the response of the neuron. So for a V1 simple cell in space and time, this might look like this. So if we go back about 30 milliseconds in time, then we have a spatial receptive field where we have this elongated shape, positive shape, and an elongated negative shape. And if we go back through time, then we see this becomes more pronounced and then fades again. So this convolution can be not only in one or two dimension, like in the case of an electrical line lobe, but it can be actually also in three dimensions, so where we go over space and time. We can see in this case that the neuron's latency, a quantity that we already also discussed, so the delay between a change in the stimulus and a change in firing that is related to it, was probably about 75 milliseconds, because here the receptive field has its most strong expression. We can also see that if we just cut these receptive fields here in a single line, we see that the amplitude here is highest. Actually, it slightly reverses here towards the end. Over time, if we just look across the temporal dimension, let's say of the top pixel here, then we get a curve like this. So first it gets activated, then reversed. A receptive field such as this is called a space-time separable receptive field. So if we just plot one spatial dimension and the temporal dimension here, this means that we can obtain our two-dimensional receptive field simply by a multiplication of a spatial and a temporal kernel. So the two-dimensional receptive field can be decomposed into two one-dimensional receptive fields. We have a spatial kernel and a temporal kernel. So how do we look at, let's say, the direction selectivity of such a receptive field or orientation selectivity of such a receptive field? For that, we need to be able to show a moving grating in a space-time diagram, otherwise it gets hard to show. So here again, we have the spatial representation where x and y are spatial coordinates, and we move this grating here over time in this direction, so towards smaller x. So that means if we just plot x and t over time, this movement here, parallel to the x-axis, this will look like these diagonal stripes here. So for a certain point x, this one here for example, a little bit after the movement starts, the gray bar will appear This corresponds to a movement into this direction. So how can we think about orientation selectivity with these space-time separable responses? Well, in this scenario here, where the grating is moving into this direction, the black curves are the black spots in the receptive field are aligned with the black spots, bar in the grating, and the white spots in the receptive field are aligned with the white bars in the grating. Of course, at another phase of the motion, the black spots in the grating are aligned with the white bars, and the white spots in the receptive field are aligned with the black bars. And this results in a modulation of the response over time. Also, if we move the grating in the opposite direction, this occurs essentially identically, and these curves look the same. So in both cases, if we move a grating over such a space-time separable Gabor-like receptive field, then the direction of the movement doesn't matter. So how can we find direction selectivity? How can we make a receptive field direction selective? For that, we actually need a non-separable receptive field. So we need in the space time diagram of the receptive field, we need a tilted axis. Because if we have such a non-separable space-time receptive field, then in this case, the alignment here is large, resulting in a high response, and here the inhibition is also large, while if the movement is going into the opposite direction, there's almost no response, no matter how the alignment is at any given point in time. So for direction selectivity, we need a space-time separable, non-space-time separable receptive field. Now we talked a lot about relationships between stimuli and responses and space-time separable receptive fields and non-space-time separable receptive fields. Now we would like to go to data analysis. So often we summarize this relationship as a simple predictive model. It's the so-called linear nonlinear Poisson model, or LNP model. In the LNP model, we assume that we have a stimulus. It has either one or two spatial dimensions and a time dimension. The model neuron has receptive fields, linear filters. The result of the applying these linear filters in space and time to the stimulus is passed through a nonlinearity. And then with some noise defining process, in our case of the LNP neuron, usually a Poisson process, we generate responses of the neuron. How can we estimate the parameters of such a neuron? One quantity that we are interested in here is the so-called spike-triggered ensemble. The spike-triggered ensemble, we look at those stimuli that preceded a spike. So if this is our response with spikes at these time points, then we extract from the stimulus the part that was occurring shortly before the spike. And what we are then interested in is looking at any meaningful structure in that spike-triggered ensemble. If we illustrate that in two dimensions, it could, for example, look like this. So in black, we have all the possible stimuli, and in white are the stimuli that elicited a spike. The first quantity that we can compute from the spike-triggered ensemble, and also an easy estimate of our receptive field, is the so-called spike-triggered average. We just take these individual components of the spike-triggered ensemble, sum them up, and divide by the number of spikes to obtain a spike-triggered average. So in our two-dimensional scenario again, if these white ones are the spike-triggered ensemble, their average is the spike-triggered average, which points in this direction. This spike-triggered average tells you what a neuron in general, on average, prefers. We can also illustrate that again here. So again, in this one-dimensional stimulus, we have spikes at these time points, and then we cut out the stimulus before them, we put them underneath one another, and we simply compute the spike-triggered average by summing them up and dividing by the number of spikes. So this would be a neuron that strongly reacts to a dip in the stimulus. Spike-triggered average, again put formally, is this. Now, if our stimulus is a white noise stimulus, so that means that spatially and temporally there are no correlations in the stimulus, then the linear receptive field as defined in the beginning in terms of such a series expansion is actually the spike-triggered average for a white noise stimulus and our LNP neuron. This is also true. In general, however, this need not be the case, and we will discuss that in a bit. One thing maybe to note here is that in many cases we write our notation continuously in space and time, because space and time are continuous quantities. But for the computer scientists among you, of course, it's very hard to represent continuous signals in the computer accurately, so we simply discretize space and sum and turn all our integrals into nice sums and compute the quantities like this. So as I already said, the spike-triggered average is a estimate of the receptive field, but in some cases it is biased. For example, if the stimulus is non-white, so that if there are correlations in the stimulus, and this is, for example, the case if you show natural movies instead of just simple white noise. In this case, we can do maximum likelihood estimation. Like in the case of our tuning functions, we again assume a log likelihood, assume a Poisson likelihood, where the spikes in a given time bin are distributed according to a Poisson distribution with parameter lambda, so the rate parameter lambda. And in this case, the rate is not specified by a one-dimensional tuning functions, but rather by the product of the receptive field with a stimulus. Then we can write down the likelihood, compute the negative log likelihood, and compute the derivative, differentiate with respect to the parameters of the receptive field. You can do that in the exercises at home. And then we can take an optimizer, optimize the likelihood to find its maximum and the estimate of the linear filter, for example, in the LNP neuron model in general for arbitrary stimuli. One problem when you do that is that your estimate are unbiased on average, but have high variance. So if this is the true receptive field with some amount of data, you will get a maximum likelihood estimate that looks like this. This is, of course, undesired because it's really, really noisy. You can see the overall shape, but it's almost covered in noise. What we can do instead is we can regularize our estimate, or in a Bayesian setting, compute a maximum a posteriori estimate where we enter our pre-assumptions about how receptive fields should look like into our inference framework. We could write that in a graphical model like this. So our response y is determined by a stimulus x and a receptive field k, and we have some hyperparameters over this receptive field k that determine its properties. This is also called a prior in Bayesian inference. This part here determines the likelihood. This is what we already had before, but what is new is this prior with hyperparameters. And then we take the receptive field that maximizes the a posteriori probability, so the receptive field k, which maximizes the product of likelihood and prior. There's of course a whole range of different priors that one could use. So if your prior is that the coefficients follow a normal distribution, then your penalizer is something like this. This is equivalent to the so-called Ridge penalty or L2 shrinkage. If you don't remember these terms, you might want to go back to the respective lecture of the Machine Learning 1 lecture series that I've linked above. And then with this L2 shrinkage, you already get much better estimates of your receptive field coefficients. At least the variance is reduced by quite a bit. You can also put a Laplace distribution as a prior, or use a Laplace distribution as a prior, and that is equivalent to using a lasso penalty, or L1 shrinkage. This induces sparseness in the coefficients of your receptive field. In this case, you can see that many of these entries here are actually pushed to exactly zero. Overall, the receptive field then looks a bit more zigzaggy than before, but it follows quite nicely the overall shape. These are good, but one can even do better with two techniques called automatic locality detection and automatic smoothness determination. Automatic locality determination, you get a filter estimate such as this by assuming that in space-time your receptive field is localized. So as a prior, you somehow localize your receptive field in space-time. Then you need in your prior, you not assume that your coefficient estimates are independent anymore, but you need a covariance matrix for your prior distribution. This can look such as this. You can also do that. So this was assuming locality in space, but you can also assume locality in the Fourier space, meaning that only some Fourier components are allowed to be active. So you put a prior on your Fourier spectrum. And this works actually surprisingly well. And you can also combine the two priors and get already really good estimates of the receptive field shape. Now, how do we find the hyperparameters of such models? So now, until now, we just simply assumed them. But the authors in the paper on which this presentation here is based, so Mijung Park and Jonathan Pillow, they use a technique called empirical Bayes. So for empirical Bayes, we're in this Bayesian framework. But we compute this term here called the evidence, and we simply use that hyperparameter that maximizes the evidence. And for some models, it's actually possible to compute the evidence in reasonably closed form or reasonably efficiently. So from that, we get a whole zoo of different receptive field estimation methods that are all better than the naive maximum likelihood estimate. So one can put L2 shrinkage or Ridge penalty, lasso penalty, and then various priors in space frequency or in space frequency that localizes, based on some pre-knowledge, localizes our estimates of the receptive fields already and obtains, with only very little data, very good receptive fields estimates. You can also apply that to real data, and you can see that here these maximum likelihood estimates with only 1 minute of data, they all have clearly discernible shapes, but are quite noisy. The background is noisy. There's lots of fluctuations. If you use the automatic locality determination in space and frequency, all of this noise in the background is gone and the structure comes out really nicely. This almost looks better than using the maximum likelihood estimate with all data, which I think in this case were about 20 minutes worth of recording. So by using an inductive bias in your model, you get estimates that are much more data efficient. Now, what I brushed under the carpet so far is that to compute the empirical base solution for the hyperparameters, we need to use a linear Gaussian model. So we need to use a model where we have a linear receptive field with Gaussian noise. It can't be a linear nonlinear Poisson model. But of course, it would be nice to also be able to compute such good data efficient receptive fields in the linear nonlinear Poisson model. And also optimizing this, doing this evidence optimization step is often very time consuming. So what we have recently done is we developed an efficient alternative, namely to use a spline basis. Here we have a prior belief that we specify in our choice of basis function, in this case, splines. Splines are smooth functions, or the smoothest possible function with certain criteria. And a certain class of splines that we use here are these. And you can see they look like these Gaussian heads with a little bit of wobble on the sides. And using these spline bases, we can easily approximate different shapes of receptive fields, for example, such as this. Or we can also do so in two dimensions, because now spline bases can be also efficiently computed in more than one dimension. And then we can use multiple of these basis functions, for example, and approximate a space-time receptive field. What do we gain by that? If we take our high-dimensional stimulus, because each pixel is a dimension, and over time as well, for all of those we have independent coefficients, and we can we use a spline basis in that, we reduce the dimensionality of the stimulus space from that of the number of pixels in our three-dimensional receptive field to the number of spline basis components that we need. If you do that, one can also get very nice-looking receptive field estimates. So here is the spike-triggered average, the widened spike-triggered average. And here's a maximum likelihood estimator with a spline basis, and here with an added L1 penalty in the spline basis. And you see that without this framework of automatic locality determination or detection, we get as good estimates as in this Bayesian framework. So what about cells that are nonlinear in their computations? In one of the last lectures, we briefly talked about complex cells and the Hubel and Wiesel model of complex cells. So their idea was that simple cells in the cortex, they are generated by projections of LGN neurons with centers around receptive fields in an orderly manner that creates these striped Gabor-like receptive fields in simple cells. Now, complex cells were thought to be a combination of simple cells that have the same preferred orientation, but different preferred phases of the stimulus, so that the complex cell overall would be insensitive to the phase of the stimulus. The linear receptive field for such complex cells is actually just flat. So if you want to model their response, you need to do something more clever. In general, the dominating model for complex cells is the so-called energy model, where we have this pair of filters, a cosine and a sine filter, so that are combined by a quadratic nonlinearity and added up. And through this operation, this quadratic nonlinearity, we make the response of the cells insensitive to the precise position of the stimulus, so induce some position invariance. We can recover such filters with a technique, for example, called spike-triggered covariance. So in spike-triggered covariance, we take again our spike-triggered ensemble. So in this case, let's say the, the white points. The average of these white points is exactly in the origin or in the middle of the stimulus distribution a priori. But the shape of the distribution is different. So we take the spiked ensemble, compute its covariance matrix, and do an eigenvector analysis, pretty much like PCA, and use these eigenvectors that kind of fall out of the spectrum as spike-triggered components, as spike-triggered covariance components. Here, if we have a model neuron that is specified according to our complex soil model, so with these two filters and quadratic nonlinearities that are summed up, our STA will be unstructured. But if we look at the eigenvalue spectrum, then there are two filters or two components, two eigenvalues that clearly stick out. So this falloff is quite typical of eigenvalue spectra, but these ones are higher than expected. And these two components here, they nicely recover our original filters despite this quadratic nonlinearity. In the next lecture, we will talk more about this kind of subunit models and how to fit them. Thank you for your attention.